Hey guys, this video is all about nutrition. I'm going to talk about the essential things you need to know when you are entering a fat loss phase and wanting to make a transformation. So this video is made for my members of my Elite 28-Day Conquering Quarantine Challenge, but I figured I would just make it a public YouTube video because there's lots of good information anyways, but I'm going to be referring to the nutrition guide, so if you're wondering what I'm talking about, that's what I'm talking about. You can sign up for the challenge too. It's gonna be friggin' awesome. It starts on Monday, May 18th. Today is Tuesday the 12th, so you have until Sunday to sign up, but you're gonna receive your grocery list and all the recipes, so you definitely wanna sign up sooner rather than later so you can start grocery shopping and gathering up the things you need. And then Monday we're gonna start and it's gonna be friggin' awesome. At the end, there's gonna be prizes. The main winner is gonna get $1,000. Oh my god, and I'm gonna be doing the challenge with you guys, and oh, I'm just so excited. So yeah, this video is just everything you need to know. It's long, so if you need to, you can listen to this while you're doing stuff. Like, you could do some cardio and listen to it. You could go for a walk. If you had to clean the house, do the dishes, you can just listen to it. And honestly, you could even listen to it a couple times just to really absorb the information, because if your knowledge is really lacking in nutrition, a lot of the time people will either just make mistakes that are such easy fixes, or they'll even just make things more difficult for themselves than necessary, which can make it really difficult to see results that last. So this stuff is important. I've also put the timestamps below, so if there's a specific question you have or something you're wondering, take a look at that and see if I answer it in this video. If not, just post in the private Facebook group with your question. And if there's a lot of questions, I'll make another video. And that's about it. That's it. So, whew, I am so excited. If you have not signed up for the challenge yet, sign up below. Let's get into the video. Okay, so we are just going to talk about the essentials, the things you need to know in order to get, not just get results, but maintain results. So even though this is a challenge and people are maybe feeling a little competitive, really wanting to see results, I don't want people just purposely starving themselves and taking extreme approaches. That is the opposite of what I want you to do, because extreme approaches result in extreme disappointment. When you take a very rigid, restrictive approach, yeah, you might see results really, really quickly, but then you can lose those results just as quickly. So I'm not trying to just get you, I got a hair in my face. I'm not trying to just get you a before and after picture. I want to make sure your after picture is good too. I don't want you to just rebound and lose all the hard work that you put in. So keep that in mind. Having a little bit of patience and not going super, super fast will really pay off in the long run, because basically the winners of the challenge, of course, partially the physical transformation will be taken into account, but it's also just going to be who has like an overall good transformation. For example, a lot of my clients, if you go to my Laura's Lifting Squad page and you read through some of the messages people have sent with their transformations, often they'll say that yes, they had a good physical change, but now like their mental outlook on fitness, their outlook on fitness and nutrition and everything is just better. They just, I feel like they have a better lifestyle overall. So that's kind of what I want you guys to aim for. I don't want you to be torturing yourself and not actually building these habits as we go along, because I want this to be a transformation that you can just keep getting better, keep getting better. So yeah, that being said, let's get started and talk about the basic things that you need to know. So when it comes to your eating, there's no need to be obsessive over little tiny details. I've been there myself, and it's just, again, it just ties into the extreme approaches. If you're just obsessing over little tiny details, like exact macro splits, exact meal timing, just who knows what else, that it's just too much and it's not maintainable. So all I want you to do, and this is what I do, this is what my clients do, this works, this is proven to work. All you have to do is have a daily calorie goal, and then you just want to make sure you're eating enough protein. So when you go through your day, you'll track your food. Even if you are following the meal plans, you still should track, just because different brands, different calories and stuff like that can vary. Plus then you still have that flexibility. It's not like you rigidly need to stick to the meal plan. You can swap things in and out. So if you're tracking on MyFitnessPal, that's gonna be very easy to do. So yeah, you got your calories, which you can use the link I provided to calculate that. And then from there, to calculate your protein goal, you want to have anywhere from absolute minimum 0.7 grams per pound of body weight up to 1 gram of protein per pound of body weight. You can go a little bit over that too if you're someone who easily hits protein. I think for the majority of people, it's the opposite. It's not easy to hit protein. So keep that in mind, that it's normal at first for it to be a little bit of a struggle. And by pre-planning your foods, that's going to help a lot. I mean, if you're not sticking to the meal plan, if you are, that'll help you see how big portion sizes for protein can be. Now, I will throw in here that if you're somebody who previously was not eating a lot of protein, you can spend the first week just slowly ramping up your protein intake, because if you're not used to it, you may feel a little bit bloated and gassy, but at the end of the day, protein is very, very, very beneficial for any type of physical change, because what it's gonna do is it helps you build and maintain lean muscle. When you have muscle, that's what's going to give you the like the toned look. And it's also going to keep your metabolism up, because again, it's helping your muscles. So protein is very, very, very important. Do not sleep on it. Do not just be like, oh, whatever, it's protein, I'll just ignore that and have my calories. So that's very important. Now, for calories, I think a lot of people will overthink things a little bit as well. So calculate your number on the calculator, but then also try and take into account how you've been eating recently. Because let's say you've just been eating anything and everything. Let's say you've been eating like 3,500 calories a day. If you go from that and just jump right down to 1,500, these are just random numbers I'm throwing out, that's like a really big decrease, and it may just be too drastic. Again, it might not be the most sustainable. So you can start a little on the higher side for the first week, see how you feel, and then decrease from there. As for number of meals a day, it doesn't necessarily have to be the same frequency as written in the meal plan, but I will say have an open mind, because I know a lot of the times when I have one-on-one clients come to me, they'll come in saying that they want to eat small frequent meals, and that's fine, I don't say no to that, but then usually a lot of the time as they go through, they'll end up being like, oh, I'm feeling really hungry, and then we'll try out having them eat just a couple larger meals a day, and a lot of the time they do find they feel fuller. Because when you think about it, a small meal, it's so small. It's like you're having a little snack, so it's like you never feel truly full. It's just like you're grazing all day. So if that works for you, that's totally fine, but just keep in mind that there's no one right way to do it. And if you're somebody who wants to follow an intermittent fasting style approach, that's fine as well. At the end of the day, hit your calories, hit your protein. That's all that matters. Yeah. And then also once a week, like on the weekend, you can have an untracked treat meal. So you don't want to go crazy, especially because the challenge is a short period of time, because what happens is your body's not running on a 24-hour clock. What it actually is it's more of an average for the week. So let's say you do really, really well all week, but then on Saturday you eat 10,000 calories. We're just making this amount dramatic here. That's gonna take you out of your caloric deficit for the week and hold you back. So I would suggest just keeping your treat meals under control. Just go a couple hundred calories over your daily intake. I can probably put out more videos on this if this is something people need help with. So that's all I'll touch on for now. So the concept of just hitting your calories and protein as opposed to really worrying about all macros, I call it the one macro method, because you're focused on protein and calories and then everything else falls into place. So within a calorie and a protein range, the carbs and fats can really vary a lot. Think of it this way, like if you did 4 times 4, that's 16, but 2 times 8 is also 16. So it's kind of just like, you could have 1800 and say 130 protein, and then the carbs and fats could be a variety of numbers. Like basically if the fats end up higher, then by default, your carbs will end up being lower in order to stay in your calories and hit your protein, or vice versa. That's why it's really nice, because say one day you're craving fats a little more, some days I'll be like, you know what, I just want a lot of avocado and peanut butter, and I don't have to worry about being like, oh no, but I don't have enough fats for that. No, I do. I just have to make sure I stay within my calories. So that's that. That's, it's very, very simple and easy, because it's so much less work. You just throw, sorry, I have a spoon in a bowl near me and I keep hitting it. You have just, all you do is throw your food into MyFitnessPal, and then you just keep an eye on the cows, keep an eye on the protein. Ta-da! Easy peasy lemon squeezy! Okay, so another really important thing with your nutrition is flexibility and knowing that there's technically no food that's off limits. There's no food that you have to eliminate. People will say, do I have to cut out sugar? Am I allowed to eat bread? And yes, you can. As long as you're hitting your calories and protein for the day. Now, there are a couple things to keep in mind. Typically, foods that are more nutrient dense and healthier, those are going to fill you up more, because often they're higher volume for a given amount of calories. So for example, let's say like a Pop-Tart. For this little square, you have 200 calories, and that's not filling whatsoever. Whereas if you had 200 calories of broccoli, I know that sounds so much less appealing than a Pop-Tart, 200 calories of broccoli is like a huge, huge amount. And I know like that's probably not what you're gonna do. But if you think of it that way, so if someone's in a caloric deficit and they're a little bit hungry, they're gonna wanna pick foods that are gonna fill them up more. They're not gonna wanna use their calories up on something not filling. It's kind of like, you want to think about it as like a budget. That's what flexible dieting is. So let's say if we were talking about a budget, say you have a monthly budget, I keep saying that word, and once you've paid like your bills, your groceries, essential things, any money you have left over, you could spend on stuff a little bit more frivolous and fun. And it's the same kind of thing with your calories. So you want to make sure you're hitting your calories and your protein. You do want to get enough fiber as well. For women, that's about minimum 23-ish grams. Men, I think it's like minimum 33-ish grams. And you won't hit that if you're not picking nutritionally dense foods. So keep that in mind. So it's like, you want to have the treats in moderation. Otherwise, you're not going to feel as satisfied. You're not going to have as much energy. So technically, the more calories you have to work with, the easier it is to fit in treats. If you're eating like 1400 calories, you don't have a lot of wiggle room. So you probably, I don't suggest trying to fit in much fun stuff. But if you're somebody who can eat 2000 calories a day, you've got a lot more wiggle room to add in a little bit more treats. So keep that in mind though, just that nothing's totally off limits, because if you think that way, again, it just creates this all or nothing extreme mindset. You start to really crave whatever it is that you're craving. You can't stop thinking about it. And then that's when you restrict everything and you're like, oh my God, I miss this food so much. And then you fall off track and then things are bad. So yeah, just know that you can eat things in moderation. And let's say like the odd time, maybe if you're really, really craving something and you fit it in your calories and then you don't end up hitting your protein, that's not the end of the world. The odd day under protein is fine. So don't stress yourself. It's more like most of the time you want to hit your protein. So yeah, you don't have to cut out sugar or bread. I eat bread often. I now, again, so when it comes to something like say white bread, that's, it's not bad for you. It's just not going to be as filling as say a bread with like more fiber in it. So yeah. Okay. So on that note, let's kind of talk about little tips and tricks to stay fuller and reduce cravings. So I mentioned high volume foods. So basically, like I said, if 200 calories of broccoli is a huge ass portion, 200 calories of, let's say, peanut butter this time, peanut butter is so small too. It's tragic. So think about that. Like, look at your foods and think about the calories and how much space it's taking up. Because literally, if it's taken up more space, it's going to be more filling. So high volume foods like that, they send satiation signals to your brain because your food is literally filling your stomach. So keep that in mind. And then high fiber foods, so that kind of builds off the same point. High fiber foods are also known to be more satiating. It basically ferments in your gut, which triggers signals in your brain to feel full. So for example, a vegetable that's a little bit more water-based, say like cucumber, it may not fill you up as much as something high in fiber like broccoli. Obviously that doesn't mean don't eat cucumber. Cucumber's awesome, but it's like the fiber is gonna fill you up more. So the third thing that's gonna be filling is protein. Protein. Protein, like your body just depends on it for so many vital functions, especially recovery. And when you haven't consumed enough protein, your body just craves it and desires it, and you're gonna feel more hungry. And that can just keep driving your appetite until you've consumed enough. So eating enough protein is crucial for results, and it will fill you up more. So eat your protein. And a lot of the time when people first start eating enough protein, it's difficult. Like you may even feel a little bit bloated and gassy at first. So if you need to eat a little bit lower the first week and gradually ramp your way up, that is totally fine. I don't want you feeling like crap just to hit your protein. So just gradually add, and that's totally fine. It's a marathon, not a sprint. Now, on the note of calorie dense foods, you really have to make sure you are tracking those carefully. So something like a vegetable, you don't have to like, okay, so let's go back to the broccoli or cucumber. If you have, say, 200 grams of cucumber or 250 grams of cucumber, it really doesn't matter. The calories are gonna be the calorie differences are gonna be pretty minimal. Whereas on the other hand, something like peanut butter, it is insane how much of a difference just little amounts can make. So for very high calorie things like peanut butter, oils, you do want to measure those a little bit more meticulously, because it's so easy to just accidentally consume a couple extra 100 calories. And again, if you're somebody who's in like, who needs to be in a fairly decent, like fairly large deficit, I mean not huge, but if you're someone who's eating like say 1600 calories a day, going a few hundred calories over is definitely gonna really put you out. So really keep that in mind, that the calorie dense things, it's a lot of the time it's the stuff higher in fats, like unfortunately even avocado. You don't just want to have unlimited avocado. Yes, these foods are healthy and they're good for you, but you can't just consume unlimited amounts, unfortunately. I wish you could. I could eat so much peanut butter and avocado. Okay, so I'm just gonna run over a couple little things in the nutrition book that I just want to talk about, bring to your attention. So the first thing, I'm just looking at the book now. So a couple of the ingredients, I just wanted to bring up a couple stuff. So the one thing, it's in one of the shakes, and it's called xanthan gum, and then I put or guar gum. Now you can find this in health sections at the grocery store. You can also order it online from Amazon. However, it's not like essential. Basically what that ingredient is it kind of just, it thickens up the shake. So I know a lot of products, or not a lot of products, but products like puddings and stuff have it. It can just add a thicker consistency. You don't want to add too much, otherwise it kind of gets a weird slimy consistency. So just keep that to a minimum. But if you don't have it, it's not like you're gonna ruin everything. It'll still taste good. It just won't be as thick. So that's that. I wanted to address that because I don't want people to be like, oh my God, what's xanthan gum? Oh my God, what do I do? So that's the one thing. Next thing I wanted to touch on was the crumbled cauliflower that is in It's in day 3. It's in the edamame poke. So that's technically, it's meant to be like a rice substitute. So depending on your calories, you could have rice instead, but especially if you're towards the lower end range, like say 1400, you're gonna save a lot of calories by having the crumbled cauliflower. Now to save the extra effort, you can buy it pre-crumbled. So you can buy it in a bag that's like steamable that you can microwave, or you can even get frozen crumbled cauliflower. So that's what I would do, because who wants to do that yourself? Not me. So just keep that in mind. You can find this, your pre-rice cauliflower. You can get it already done for you, and then that's just gonna make your life so much easier. And same thing with zucchini noodles. In the frozen section, you can find them pre-noodled. You can find the zucchinis. They'll be already in noodle form. So again, gonna make your life a lot easier. And when it's the frozen one, it's not, the price is normal. I find if you get like, at least where I'm, the grocery store I go to, if you get like the fresh zucchini noodles, it's like an arm and a leg. But if you get it in frozen, you're good to go. So that's a little tip for you there. A little tip. Okay, and then the next thing I wanted to touch on, it kind of just builds off of that, is just frozen veggies in general. It is so much easier. So I know for me, a lot of my clients, it just makes life so much easier. So I personally enjoy cooked veggies the most, but I don't like cooking them. I don't like washing them. I don't like cutting them up. I do not like cooking, you guys. Like, if you are like, oh, I can't reach my fitness goals because I'm really busy or I don't know how to cook or whatever, do not worry. I am the laziest cook of life. I don't, like, I can cook, but I just choose not to. Like, the only thing I cook is eggs. So yeah, frozen veggies will be your best friend. And like I said, because all you do is you just take it out of the bag, you just put it in a bowl, and then you can microwave it to cook it, ba-bam, you're good. And the thing is too, that frozen veggies can actually be higher in nutrients because they're frozen at like their peak point. So the nutrients haven't deteriorated yet. So yeah, frozen veggies, nothing wrong with them. Nothing wrong with them. So that's what I do. You don't have to, but it's so easy. And you just throw it in the microwave, add a little bit of seasoning, ba-bam, you're done. And also, one more thing on top of that. I'll lay out my veggies in the morning so they can just kind of start defrosting on their own. Because I find as the day goes, if I'm like tired and getting hungry, I'll even not want to wait for them to defrost in the microwave. So if I already have it sitting in a bowl, defrosting, doing its thing, then when it's time to eat, all I have to do is like heat it up. So easy. So that's a big tip I got for you there. And then the other thing is just there's no rigid rules. So if you want to swap out a food for something else, that's totally fine. If you want to maybe split some of your meals. Like I know in the higher calorie ranges, some of the meals are pretty large. So if you want to split that in half and have it like a snack, you can. I do that all the time with my breakfast, like my Laura's favorite breakfast, the eggs with the egg whites, because for myself, I'll make so many egg whites. I'll have like a cup of egg whites and three eggs. So then typically I'll end up saving those egg whites for a little later as like a little small meal slash snack. So you can do something like that too if you want. Again, I can't say it enough. At the end of the day, as long as you're hitting your calories and your protein, you can kind of do whatever. You can even combine your meals. Like maybe you're really busy and you just want to eat two big meals a day. I don't know. Or maybe like just whatever. So you can swap things out. You can use foods that are not on the food list as well. Those are just like suggestions and ideas. But yeah, at the end of the day, just hit your calories and protein and you'll be fine. You'll be fine. Because flexibility is key, people. Okay, so I'm just going to quickly touch on diet breaks. So this is something where I can make a full separate video about it. I'm gonna try to keep this brief, but I just want to make you aware of the process, the technique, just because it's kind of good to know sometimes to think like, okay, what's coming next? What am I gonna do next? So a diet break is a fairly short period of time, a week, maybe even 2 weeks, where you bring your calories up to maintenance. Depending on how much cardio you're doing, you can reduce your cardio a little bit as well. So this is something you implement after a period of being in a caloric deficit. So if someone's experiencing just like a lot of hunger, they're noticing their energy levels are going down, they're just really like, they're not recovering well from their workouts, that's a sign that it may be time to do a diet break. If you do it properly, you're not going to gain any body fat back. It's just going to kind of allow you to come back stronger, not just physically, but mentally as well. So there's actually been studies that have shown that people who implemented diet breaks into their fat loss phase, they lost more weight and they kept it off longer. So that's pretty cool. So basically the point that I'm getting for this is that if you wanted to, I'm not telling anyone to go in a very aggressive caloric deficit, but if you want to take it like a little bit more aggressive, like let's say maybe you would, if you were not in the challenge, you would start at 1800, but maybe you want to start at 1650 and that's a little low. That's it's all right as long as you're like in a healthy, good mindset, but you have to have an exit strategy. If you're gonna go into a little bit of a stricter deficit, you can't just go in blind. You have to have an exit strategy. I'm just gonna say that again, because otherwise you risk getting to, say you have your pretty big deficit for 4 weeks, then after the 4 weeks, you're like, oh my God, I'm so hungry, I have such bad cravings, and then you fall off track, and then you just start overeating, and then you start putting all the weight back on. So if you have planned a diet break, it can kind of help you hold on. So if you're like, oh, like I'm getting a little bit of cravings, and you're like, okay, well, I know that I'm gonna have my diet break after these 4 weeks. So what you could do is do the 4 weeks, and then you could do a diet break for 1 week, and then you would go back into your caloric deficit. So just keep in mind that your maintenance, if you've lost weight, your maintenance is not going to be as high. So let's say I lose 10 pounds, my maintenance isn't going to be the same as it is now. So this is something, there's a lot of little fine details to this. So if after the challenge you're taking this really seriously and you wanna take it to the next level, we can book a call and discuss signing up for my one-on-one coaching. And that's something where we can really look at the nitty-gritty details and make sure you're properly implementing your diet break. And because you can even do it again in the future. So let's say after these 4 weeks, you do your diet break, and then you would stick to a deficit for another period of time, and then eventually go on a diet break. There's not like, for anything with nutrition, like diet breaks, reverse dieting, there's not like concrete rules. It's never like, oh, after exactly 5 weeks, you must eat at maintenance for 7 days, and you would add this exact amount of calories and this and this and this, because everybody's bodies are so, so different. Like even when it comes to calculating calories, there's just so much background info that you have to know, or I have to know, in order to give you the proper answer. Because people will say like, oh, so how often should I do a diet break? And basically it's like I said, if you're starting to feel really low energy, really run down, you're not recovering, then you know, then that's when you want a diet break. So you wouldn't necessarily need to do it after the 4 weeks. If the 4 weeks were up and you still felt great, you wouldn't need to do a diet break yet. So it's kind of just like a case by case basis, and it would depend on you and how your body is responding. So I can make more videos on this, and that's all for diet breaks. But basically it'll just kind of maintain your sanity and maintain your strength and just make the process a lot better. One last thing I'll throw in on that is that you could even, for like women, you could even plan a diet break. You could technically do it as a monthly thing. You could do it during, if you're somebody who, like when you get your period or the week before you get your period, if you're someone who gets really, really hungry and a lot of cravings, you could plan each month to have that week a maintenance week, and then it's just gonna help make your life easier. So, and then if you know the other weeks you're still in a deficit, if you plan to eat at maintenance, it's easier to stick to, obviously, than a deficit. So then you don't risk like binging and going crazy. So that is a diet break. It's not a free for all. It's just simply like a little break where you're maintaining, but you're not like feasting. Okay, so another thing I wanted to quickly touch on is a calorie counting mistake a lot of people make, and that is listening to the calorie burn on your fitness tracker. So whether that be a Fitbit or an Apple Watch, these devices are known to be very inaccurate. It's usually gonna say you burnt a lot more than you actually did. So do not adjust your calories according to what your fitness tracker says. Just don't even look at that. Like I use my Apple Watch to count my steps and things like that, but I don't even look at the calories because it's just not accurate. And really what you should be doing is calculating your calorie intake according to your activity level just from the get-go. So when you use the calculator I shared, you would put that you have, like if you're somebody who's quite active, you would put that, and then you would come up with your daily calorie goal according to that. Or if it's the opposite, if you're someone who's less active, you would come up with your calorie goal according to that, and you would just have a little bit less calories than someone who's really active. So yeah, don't let it adjust your calories, because sometimes if you hook it up to MyFitnessPal, it'll automatically add in calories. Do not do that. It's going to take you out of your calorie deficit. So yeah, just leave it alone. Count your steps, that's cool, but don't worry about the exact calories burnt, because it's wrong. And then other thing is, when it comes to supplements, sometimes people will ask me about fat loss supplements, fat burners, appetite suppressants. save your money. A fat burner is honestly just like a lot of caffeine. Like, so it's just gonna hype you up so you can burn more calories with extra caffeine. So you could easily just use pre-workout or a lot of coffee. And then as for the appetite suppressant, you can buy cheap alternatives that work equally as well. So fiber supplements. So for example, this is a Metamucil psyllium fiber, 4-in-1 fiber. And this actually tastes pretty good. It's kind of like a nice yummy orange taste. So basically, as I mentioned before, fiber fills you up. So if you take a fiber supplement, say if between meals you're really hungry, you can take this and it'll fill you up. So you don't want to go crazy with this stuff. Like, it still has calories, first of all, so track it if you are going to do that. But you also just don't want to be like constantly relying on like supplements for fiber. But again, for some days, if you're feeling a little hungrier, it's kind of nice. The thing I actually love even more than this is fiber gummies, because then you get to have some candies and they fill you up and it's awesome. So that is a cheap alternative to a appetite suppressant. And this actually does say on the bottle that it is helps support appetite control, because it does. That's what fiber does. So rather than go buying some random supplement that says like, oh, this controls your appetite, instead just get some fiber gummies or some fiber powder and bam, you're good to go. Just don't eat all the gummies. I did that once and my stomach was like, it was so bloated. It hurt so much. So yeah, don't do that. And obviously count the calories for those too. So yeah, by using a fiber supplement, you can keep your belly full while keeping your bank account full. For supplements, like some vitamins is fine. Protein powder can help you hit your protein. Pre-workout's nice if you like to get a little kick of energy. And that is it. All right, and that is the end of this video. So hopefully this helped you guys out, gave you some insight. Hopefully you had some breakthroughs and you're like, wow, I know more now. And yeah, so if you have not signed up for the challenge yet, click the link in the description box below, because it's gonna be so awesome. I'm really excited, if you can't tell. And yeah, I'm just gonna end this video here. Like and subscribe if you enjoyed this video. And if you join the challenge, I am so freaking excited for us to go through the next 28 days together. It's gonna be amazing and so much fun. And that is it. I will see you guys in the next video. Bye.